respected brothers and elders, one, whenever you have an intention to do something, sometimes as human beings, as Muslims, you can get the odd intention, the irada, to have, do something. Something good comes to mind, something like an inspiration. I can give you 101 examples, but I'm sure you can put yourself in that situation and think, recent, perhaps not in the far past, where you've had just a thought, a good thought. Perhaps to give some sadaqah, perhaps to just do something good, to do something for your community, to do something for your family. Whatever the shape or form, whenever we have a good intention in mind, that is itself a good blessing and a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any good thought is a ni'mah and blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we think of good intentions, we generally think that if I intend to do something good, that's good. But there's also something additional to that. If you intend to stop from bad, you intend to stop from doing something guna, something sin, that also is a good intention as well. A good intention doesn't mean you want to just increase your good deeds. A good intention can also mean to decrease your bad deeds. So if someone, for example, has an issue where they, for example, now have a, unfortunately, but they use their eyes in the wrong way, they're addicted to watching explicit material online, films that perhaps they shouldn't be watching at all. So what happens is the person knows, I've got an issue, I've got a problem, inshallah, I'm gonna try and stop. That itself is a good intention. That's a blessing and ni'mah from Allah. And on your intention, you will always get rewarded. Always, you will always get a reward for making an intention for having a good deed. When a person thinks of something good, and the person intends something good, immediately you will get a complete reward just for intending that. مَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةً فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَىٰ عِنْدَهُ حَسَنَةً كَامِلَةً Whoever intends to do a good deed, whichever way, shape or form it is, small, big, wherever it is, when you intend something good, immediately you're going to get the reward for that. For example, I've got a son, I wish him to become a Hafiz of Quran. Inshallah, I'll get one reward for that already. I also plan for my daughter also likewise. So I'm going to get a reward for that. When they do complete it, وَمَنْ هَمَّ بِهَا فَعَمِلَهَا The hadith mentions then whoever so intends a good deed and then they practically follow that good deed up, meaning they do it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them a minimum of 10 times more reward. 10 times more. So this is how kind Allah is, because when you do a sin, you get one sin. Obviously, sins are different in terms, obviously zina is going to be big, qatl and murder is going to be big, interest and zulm and injustice is going to be a very big sin, but it's still just one. And on the Day of Judgment, according to the sins we've done, they'll be weighed on the Day of Judgment. However, some good deeds, they may be just one deed, but Allah in His infinite mercy multiplies it by 10. So how can someone go to Jahannam when you get 10 times more good and you only get one bad? Subhanallah. Allah could have flipped it around and said, look, because I'm giving you Jannah for free, I'm giving you Akhirah for free, I'm giving you Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam for free, we're going to flip it. You do one sin, I'm going to give you 10. So you're going to have to do more good deeds than thingy. You've got to prove yourself. Allah could have said that, but no, He didn't. Because He's so kind. He said, no, do one, you get multiplied by 10. So this is why what it is that we should make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for thought, good thought to come. May Allah please inspire me for khair, inspire me to do good. Allahumma alhimni rushdi. Allahumma awallah, inspire me to do good, inspire me to come onto the right path. Awallah, inspire me for goodness. And whenever we have a negative thought, we should repel this. And like you may hear me, I make this dua quite often. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa warzuqna ittiba'a wa arina al-batila batila warzuqna ijtinaba'a. I constantly make this dua and I recommend others to learn it and make it. It mentions, Allah, arina al-haqqa haqqa, Allah, show me good as good and let me see evil for evil and give me the ability to practice good and abstain from the evil. So what it is, I'm asking Allah, you know what's good. Let me also see good as good, because unfortunately before the times of Qiyamah, good people and good things will be seen as bad. Good things will be seen as bad, and bad things will be seen as good. So, arina al-haqqa haqqa wallah, let me see haqq and good as truthful, and give me the ability to practice it. And let me see batil and falsehood as it is, and give me the ability to abstain. So, but whenever we repel a negative thought, this is an act of mujahada, you will get rewarded on this particular action. Understand like this, any good deed that comes in your mind is similar to a guest from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a ni'mah, a blessing. Now put ourselves in a worldly context, you've got a guest that comes to your house, okay? If you entertain that guest, welcome them in, salam wa salam, call them in, and you mashallah look after that guest, entertain that guest, feed that guest, In future, they'll think to themselves, I'm going to go to, mashallah, Sajjad's house in the future again. I'm going to go to Jubair's house in the future. I'm going to go to Muhammad's house in the future. Because, mashallah, they showed so much izzat and respect. But if someone comes to the door, and the first thing you think of is, yaar, ye kebab ki haddi kahan se aa gaya? You know, kebab mein haddi. You know, we give this example in Urdu. When you eat kebab, it's all soft and minced in it. But when you bite them, there's a bone. Like, right, where did this bone come from? Keema's supposed to be soft. There's a parrot, an example, that kebab mein haddi. So when someone comes to your door, oh, assalamu alaikum alhamdulillah. Yeah, bro, I'm just a bit busy. Yeah, but maybe come back another time. Even though, shara'an, it's permissible to do that, and the person won't be sinful for telling you to come at another time. With akhlaq. Like, for example, brother, I'm so happy to see you. You just caught me at a bad time. Is it possible perhaps we could meet another time? And inshallah, I would love to meet you again. That's fine. And we shouldn't take offense from that. Naji, he didn't know lift nikara. He didn't even. Bro, listen, you got. Like, don't. It's not about you. It's about them as well, right? It's a bit of give and take. But I'm saying, put yourself in that situation. Even if someone asked you to go and they didn't think, next time you're still gonna have, you know, should I disturb? Shouldn't I? You know, there's gonna be a level of hesitancy perhaps in you. But definitely, if the person shuns you, and you come to the person's door and say, bro, can you just do one? Just come back another time. You're gonna think, do I ever want to go back there again? Hell no. So likewise. A good intention that comes from Allah is similar like a guest. If you entertain that guest, those thoughts are going to come back because you made shukr on the ni'mah and you thanked Allah and you appreciated that ni'mah. And that is those good thoughts which come. But when we reject them, maybe they won't come so often. So this is why we say, don't ever look down upon any small deed. Allah ma'afam, this is what shaitan will do. He'll make you think, bruv, you're so sinful. What's that one little good deed going to do? What's that one good deed going to do? Don't ever look down upon any good deed. Like the Prophet doesn't even mention it. Don't ever look down upon any act of goodness. Why? Because you don't know what's going to earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll give you an example. Maybe you've heard this. It's a very, very often quoted, and it's an authentic riwayat as well. Where a man, subhanAllah, there's two riwayat mentions exactly, but I'll mention the female one. A woman, subhanAllah, who did the most lewdest of action, which we would refer to in terms of her own izzah. She was a prostitute and she used to sell her body for money, subhanAllah. But this act was something, subhanAllah, which in Islam we completely disagree with. Okay? What happened was is that she went to a well to draw out some water and she saw that there was a dog nearby also in need of water as well. So she had rahm on that dog. Yaar, this dog also is a human, like it's a soul that breathes. So she withdrew some water, gave the water to the dog to drink. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent wahi, Allahu Akbar, to the Nabi of the time to inform him, give this act of kindness, this gesture of kindness has earned this woman's forgiveness. Okay, we're ready to overlook all what she's done because she showed act of kindness to her dog. Now Allah forbid, I mean, English people are far better when it comes to animal hukuk, really. Really. They call, wherever there's negative, we'll point the negatives out. And we're not embarrassed to either, we have a haq to. Because if I think something's wrong, I'm going to say, I don't agree with this. But if there's something good, we also have to salute the good as well. And definitely, when it comes to the hukuk of animals, mashallah, really decent people, cats, dogs, and all kind of things. I know there's an extreme as well, and this is a sign of qiyamah. It mentions in the hadith that a person looking after dogs will become more beloved than looking after one's own children and family. That's a sign of qiyamah. So let's not go too far. But the usul I'm talking about is care for an animal. Cats and so on, and generally, and they have that sort of shafqa towards creatures. Whereas, Allah rahim kare, obviously, let's not go into the negative, but you can kind of get where I'm saying. Now this woman, she did this kind gesture of doing something for a dog. You and I would think to ourselves, it's a dog. What the heck is a dog? But it's a dog. It's still a soul that breathes, Allahu Akbar. Based on that, Allah forgave all her other previous sins. Allah's qadir, he can do what he likes. So this is why we should never look down upon any good deed. You may think to yourself, like I said, look, if some of those of you have come late, I said this one thing. Don't ever look down upon any good deed. A thought may come in the heart. Do it. It may be that I want to read some Quran today. Okay, mashallah, do you know what you do? Open the Quran, just read for 1 minute. Bas, and close it. Just 1 minute. Just for 60 seconds, and then close it. Sometimes the thought comes to your mind, I should pray more. Fine, get up, do wuzu, pray just your farz namaz. Do it. Instantly do it. Someone said, you know, had a thought, I want to give some money to charity. Mashallah. Phone your charity who you like. There's mashallah loads of charities. For example, if you like a particular charity, phone up and say, can I make a donation, please? Don't think to yourself, it's only a fiver, it's only a tenner, it's only 20 quid. Bae, don't look at how much you're giving, look at who you're giving it for. It's his job to appreciate, don't worry about how much you're giving. Because if a woman can feed, give water to a dog and get her sins forgiven for being a prostitute, I'm sure Allah Ta'ala will forgive you. Rule is ikhlas, sincerity, and wanting to do it for the sake of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. The worst thing to do is procrastinate. And mashallah, that's a good deed. Inshallah, kal tu, from tomorrow. Bhai, kal kabhi bhi nahi aata. It never comes. That's exactly what shaitan wants you to do, procrastinate. Procrastination, man, trust me. Procrastination is a killer in worldly sense, in religious sense, in all sense. Trust me, procrastination is a big maraz. I'll do it tomorrow. Taswif, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it. Bruv, tomorrow never comes. It never comes. You'll get linked up with something else and khalas before you know it, time is up. Okay? So what happened? I'll give you an example. Shaitan also makes us think like this as well. And he makes us think religious sometimes. Okay, mashallah, Ramadan is around the corner, bro. So if you give the money in Ramadan, mashallah, more reward. So you think, that's mashallah, it sounds nice. So I will delay because Ramadan is around the corner. But listen, give now, that same Allah who gave you that thought to give, inshallah, will give you the tawfiq to do it again. Don't delay. Give, inshallah. And there's a couple of benefits in this as well. Couple of benefits. Like you have some masajid, for example. But please, we're raising money, we need to purchase property, we need to pay off our qarzi hasana. And I think to myself, okay, what I'm going to do? I'm going to wait till Ramadan. You know, the good thing is, if you give it there and then, there's a couple of added benefits. You know what the benefits are? When you give money to somebody, they're frantically looking to fill their money. For example, they've got 30 days to make a 30k payment. And you want to donate 1 grand, 5 grand, whatever the case may be. Now in your mind, what you're thinking is, Rab, well, if I think about it, right? Let me just cut into Ramadan. They're still going to have 5 days left. So, but do you know what it is? If you gave that money at the first of the month, when you intended to, think of the sukoon you just gave them. Someone's raising 30 grand, you just gave them 5 grand. They're going to think, oh, alhamdulillah, now I've only got to raise 25. And then they think to themselves, right, now I've got 29 days to raise 25 grand. But 5 days pass, 10 days pass, 20 days pass, 25 days pass, and they go, oh, I've only got 14 grand. The last 6 days in that person's life, they're not even going to be able to eat, even drink and sleep. Because all they're going to be thinking about is paying their bill. So there's, even though we may think to ourselves, yes, you may get more reward, undoubtedly, in terms of numbers. But you giving that money there and then, think of the pressure you alleviated that person. That itself has value. That itself has value. We shouldn't delay that. That itself has benefit. So we should think to ourselves, if a thing comes to mind, do it. Just do it. Even the jumper is telling us, but we're not doing, subhanAllah. But just do it. As soon as you think of something good, khalas, get on it. And like I said, there's something else as well, right? Is that if that same Allah who gave you that intention to do it now, I'm sure that same Allah who's so kind, for who you did it for, can he not also inspire you in Ramadan to give another 1 grand, another 5 grand, another 10 grand? But what difficult is it for Allah? So this is why we should think out of the box a little. This is why we say, bhai, ulama se poocha karo. Speaking of ulama, sometimes they look, I'm doing this, but I've had this thought, shall I delay it to Ramadan? No alim will tell you, no, delay it to Ramadan. Because they know the tricks. Shaitan, exactly how shaitan plays games. Nene, take it out right now. This good intention you made, give it out inshallah straight away. See, this is why when you say فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرٍ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of knowledge when you don't know something. Okay, so always refer to some, if you're not sure, or you have a thought, you know, my personal thought, listen, mashallah, your thought is good to an extent, but it's more beneficial for you to give now, inshallah. Finishing off, obviously, we've got a couple of minutes left. I want to touch on one more thing quickly. To value a blessing, when a blessing comes to mind, the first thing you do is shukr to Allah. Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me this intention, this good thought. Secondly, make the intention solid. Like, for example, I gave the example of the charity one. Or someone has an intention for something else. You have an intention for something? Right, inshallah, definitely. I'm going to go home and I'm going to definitely give that money, 100%. I'm going to go home, I'm going to do that tasbih. I'm going to go home, I'm going to read that Quran. Whatever it is, make sure you fix a time, intention, and do it. If you cannot do it immediately, fix the time, hold yourself accountable to that particular time. The third thing to make shukr is to act upon it. That thing which you intended, do physically act upon it. And number four, try to not act upon it once, but try to bring it in your life until the day you die. So these are some of the ways how we can show shukr and thanks to the things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives in our mind. And there's two types of people. One person who, mashallah, gets up and guns blazing, he feels all of a sudden this great burst of spirituality, and he reads 5 sparas in one go. And then what happens after that? Quran gets folded up, and he doesn't see it until Ramadan. That's one person. Or the person opens it up again when he thinks there's a jinn in the house. One of the two. So what happened is like this. Someone, mashallah, reads 5 juz and 10 juz and so on, and they, for one whole week they're smashing it, and then afterwards it's dead. It would be better for you. Let's take, for example, someone, he goes, reads 10 juz in 3 days, reads one Quran, and 27 days does nothing. That's one way of doing it. But the other way, you take out time every day and read 1 juz. Over a 30-day period. أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلْ It mentions in the hadith, you know, the most beloved actions to Allah are those that are done regularly, even though they may be small, but they're done regularly. So for you to, for example, do 1 juz a day is more loved by Allah than for you to just do 10 and then don't do nothing for 10 days. Because it's that thought, isn't it? I've got to connect to Allah, I've got to connect to Allah, I've got to do something for Allah, and you've got to constantly connect to it. So that's a whole lot better. I'll give you an example by way of dunya, right? Let's just say, for example, we fill up a baldi of water, right? Some massive drum of water. And underneath we put a stone, something as hard as a stone. If you were to just open the tuti, right, the tap, and just let all the water flow one time, the whole 90 litres, 100 litres, 500 litres, whatever, it will finish. But there's another way. Open it just a little bit and let one drop fall on a stone. Come back now tomorrow, come back in a week's time, a month's time. I guarantee you, if you touch that place where the water's dropping, you're going to see an ishan in that stone. Now if water, as delicate as it is, can impact a stone, imagine what these a'mal can do for your spirituality if done over a long period of time. A lot of people complain, I'm feeling upset, I feel depressed, I feel anxiety. By Allah told you, in the dhikr of Allah you'll find sukoon, in Allah's deen you'll find sukoon. I'm not saying this, Allah is saying this. So everyone's complaining and they're looking in the wrong avenues. Our solution is in deen, subhanAllah. So anyway, just last but not least, you know this whole jazba, this desire to want to do good. Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentions that individual who performs the janazah of salah, for the burial, they will get a qirat of reward, qirat, okay? And whosoever stays with the burial, goes, does the tadfeen and the burial and so on, they'll get 2 qirats of reward. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he heard this and he got parashan. He went to go be upset. So he went to Aisha radiallahu anha and asked her a question. He said, Abu Hurairah just said that if you were to go do the janazah salah, you get 1 qirat. And by the way, what is 1 qirat? Mount size of Mount Uhud. 1 good deed. So you do a janazah, mashallah. On the day of Qiyamah, that size of Mount Uhud will be your 1 good deed. By anyone seen Uhud here? 7 kilometers, 1 mountain. All that, 1 good deed. Now what happens? He asks Aisha, can you also verify this as well, that you get 2 qirat? And she said, yes indeed. And then he got upset. He goes, oh, do you know how many qirat I've missed out on? How many opportunities I missed out on? Allahu Akbar, yaar, unki kya sochti yaar, subhanAllah. Their whole thinking was akhirah. Our whole thing is dunya. Now imagine this. I know someone who didn't make a business deal at the right time in a certain company. The long story cut short, because obviously time is up. Bitchara, he would curse himself. Yaar, I had an opportunity in this company, I didn't invest. Had I invested, I would have got this much. Brother, it's done now. Forget it. Invest somewhere else, do something else. He was like having a go at himself all the time again. Did we ever think to ourselves, if I made my children dindar, today they would have been a coolness for my eyes. If I would have established, for example, a lot of you guys come from foreign countries. How about like hand pump in Bangladesh, for example? How about some charity work in another country? How about, I know one guy, he educates orphans. Those children, when they grow up, subhanAllah, their whole nasal is going to make dua for that person. How many opportunities have we missed out on, subhanAllah, we could have taken advantage of? And I can give you so many examples, but time doesn't permit. So just finish on this last thing, right? One person went to one scholar and he said to him that my spiritual condition is kind of low, so I feel like I'm going to go to Umrah. He said, mashallah, that's a good intention. But you know, I prescribed for you to do this action, this action, this action. And because he was a student, he prescribed his students certain actions to do. The student turned around and he said, I'm going to go to Umrah because I can't get a grip on my a'mal. He said, mashallah, go, you'll benefit, but I'm sorry to break the news. When you come back, you're gonna get into that same loop again and you're gonna do exactly the same thing. You're gonna come in 3 months, 6 months and say the same thing to me. Ki Hazrat, Ustad, Sheikh, whatever you wanna call me, I'm feeling the same situation again. He said, the only way to solve your situation is put your foot on your nafs and just do it. Put your foot on your nafs and do it. If you intend, so this is why from this Jumu'ah, make one intention that you're gonna do something different in your life. It can be anything. For example, it was the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, he advised, for example, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, 33 times after salah, Allahu Akbar 34 times. If you don't do this, make an intention that every salah from now on I'm gonna do this. If that's too long, make sure, before you go sleep, if I'm traveling, if I sleep at 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock, wherever I am in the world, whenever I go to sleep, I'm gonna do this one action. It's just a suggestion. I said, intend one action and say today, I'm gonna bring this into my life. And hook or crook, I'm gonna make sure I do this action. Slowly, that's the whole maqsad for coming here, yaar. It's not just the case, chalo ji, Jumma par le, you tick the box, alhamdulillah, I'll see you next week, ji imam sahab. Nah, yaar, change. There should be some change. There should be some connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's the maqsad of coming here? Why should I come from Crawley for the sake of Jumu'ah? Alhamdulillah, I get to see wonderful brothers, but we want to instill change in myself, in others, and move closer to Allah ta'ala. May He give us tawfiq, inshallah, and inspire us, and give us the ability to make amal and practice. Jazakumullah. Subhanallah, wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika.